Time for 5 good minutes with ESPN NBA analyst Brian Windhorst, Matt Fontana, Danny Cunningham alongside. And Brian, we certainly have a big game to recap as the Cavs get a nice win over LeBron James and the Lakers. And, you know, Wendy, I know you know this, and I got to shout out your appearance on the Really Big Show this past week, just talking the history with LeBron. If you missed it, laneondemand.com to catch all that. But to the game itself, Brian, we know how important it always is for LeBron to come back. We know how important it is, you know, for him. Certainly the game, though, and I talked to Danny about this, where I was excited to see the Cavs on that main stage, on the big stage. You know, it's still LeBron. And Brian, that game, I mean, I know individually there were a lot of runs in that, and there were certainly some issues, you know, the Cavs had, but that was just a really fun basketball game to watch. We'll talk obviously specifically about Donovan Mitchell coming up, but just your biggest overall thoughts on that game, Brian, from Tuesday night over at Rocket Mortgage Fieldhouse.
Yeah, I mean, obviously, you got a national television game. You've got LeBron, and Donovan Mitchell was awesome. I mean, I think it can be said the Cavs have a better team than LeBron does. That's never really been the case. They did last year, but it wasn't as cut and dry. And the Cavs might have a player who's maybe not every night, but they can go toe-to-toe and outplay LeBron. That's never been true in the years that he's been, you know, in the NBA and not on the Cavs, which is why it was, the record was 1-17 against LeBron coming into this year, and why it's 2-0 this year. And that was a great thing to see. You know, the Cavs have moved past him, and it doesn't mean that someday he won't come back in some form. He's talked about it, even if it's like signing a one-day contract or whatever. But the Cavs are no longer gripped by LeBron James, and I actually think that the vibe in the arena, you felt that. Like, of course, the Cavs fans are always going to embrace LeBron, but this was like when you see your ex, but you're happily married. You know, you hope they are fine, maybe, and you hope, and you're doing fine. That's kind of what it was like. And I'm worried about some things in the game, but certainly in and of itself, and if you were at the game, you got to experience a guy doing what you saw LeBron do for so many years and totally take control of the game and basically put the game in the ground, which is what LeBron's done literally hundreds of times in his career, hundreds of times in that building. So yeah, it was really great. I was disappointed at some things we can talk about. I'm worried about some things we can talk about, but the Cavs winning that type of game is a great statement on where they are as an organization.
Brian, so much in the lead up to that game was about how when LeBron and the Lakers were in town last season, the moment appeared to be too big for the guys on that version of the Cavs. It wasn't the case last night in the win for them. How much of that is because the team has matured versus how much of that is because Donovan Mitchell rises to those moments?
Here's the thing, guys. Coming into the Rocket Mortgage Fieldhouse, the Cavs are not going to be intimidated by anybody. They are one of the best teams in the league on their own floor when they're defending. They frankly don't care. I would have been interested to see what would have happened if Anthony Davis played in that game last night all the way through. Frankly, I think the Cavs probably still win because it was a really poor shooting night for the Lakers. The Cavs changed their defense after Anthony Davis went out. But they're extremely confident at home. I think they're 11-1 now at home. You see it. They played very hard last night. The compared to the game in New York on Sunday, way they started the game was vastly different. Of course, it helped to have Jared Allen back, and he got off to such a great start. He carried him early. But you're of course right. They're a different team than they were a year ago because they've got an All-NBA player that they added who played like an All-NBA player in that game, and that's what you're going to see. I'm not 100% sure that that's a recipe that's going to work long-term when bigger games happen. But, you know, without Anthony Davis, the Lakers are not that good of a team, and the Cavs should beat them. And they practically, you know, at the end of the day, even though I know there's more emotions there, it was really just a better team taking care of business.
Brian, you mentioned it earlier, and the one great thing about doing this with you every week here on our YouTube social media platform here on ESPN Cleveland, let's get into it. You mentioned some things you were a little concerned about with that, with the Cavs and the Lakers game. Just kind of what did you see?
It wasn't good that that was still a game going into the fourth quarter. The without Anthony Davis, the Cavs were totally packing the paint. The Lakers were bricking threes. I know in the third they hit a couple. Lonnie Walker hit a couple. But they're out there playing with Patrick Beverley and Dennis Schroeder, and those guys are bricking away. Westbrook is bricking away from the outside. The Cavs should not have been a game. And also in the fourth, Donovan Mitchell was awesome, but the requirement for him to be the whole offensive attack in the fourth quarter is concerning to me. I mean, when you look at, like, they're in great position, and you know, the home road split record, you see that with a lot of teams right now. There's a lot of teams that have a big variance home and road, so it's not even a Cavs thing. But if you have the number one or number two defense in the league, which they do, you shouldn't be. It shouldn't travel as poorly as they do, and they also shouldn't have to be in a possession game against a team like the Lakers in that situation at home. And the issue is that their offense has really eroded. Their offense in the first 15 games of the season was top five. In the last 10 games, they are, I think, 21st. You know, who knows what happens on Wednesday night? They could change, but 21st. And in their last eight road games, where they've gone 1-7, they're dead last in the NBA in that stretch. If you look at all NBA teams' last eight road games, the Cavs have been the worst on offense. And when you look at their offense, especially late in games, you see them way too reliant on individual playmaking with Mitchell and Garland, and you don't see enough help from the supporting cast. It is concerning that they don't have more shot makers coming off their bench, and you feel it all the time. And now you got Dean Wade banged up for a month. Caris LeVert has not shown consistency. Obviously, Okoro is not going to get it done. So, like, in the grand scheme, they're in third place. They're great. And I think if you look at the Eastern Conference standings, you kind of see the Cavs, you know, they're sort of 1-2 and then like a dotted line, and then the Cavs and like sort of another dotted line. They're ahead of the everybody else pack. But if you're going to want to be a team that advances in the playoffs, you're going to have to rely on more than Donovan Mitchell, because at the end of tough games against good teams, which the Lakers really aren't, you can't just rely on that. So I'm obviously watching Donovan Mitchell and appreciating he goes for 43 in that game on national TV. I'm watching the fans go crazy. I'm watching his defensive hustle resulting in transition baskets. That's all great. Just a little bit continued to be worried about not more diversity offensively. Evan Mobley is coming along. There's little steps forward he's making. He still sometimes is weak with the ball. His outside shot is still suspect. He's not quite there. So they're going to have to rely, and they're going to have to find some bench scoring, and they're going to have to find some more things that work than just Donovan being Donovan at the end of these games. Because I'm telling you, go ask the Jazz. In the playoffs, there are times when that's not going to work, and it might come down to that this year.
Brian, wanted to ask you about Jared Allen. You mentioned him a little bit ago about his return. The impact certainly, didn't miss a shot to start, you know, for how long, just what he did. What did you see out of Allen? And, you know, is he kind of, I feel like it's so segmented, right, Brian, about what the Cavs offense has been, where you're missing Garland, then maybe you miss this guy, miss Allen. Now we've got the full complement of players with Allen back. What'd you see in his debut, but his return from the injury?
I have to say that, like, he almost makes a pretty big impact offensively, which you honestly wouldn't think that you'd say, because, you know, defensively, the Cavs were really good without him, because Mobley is building a case for all defensive team. He, night after night after night, he does stuff defensively. You're just, like, so impressed. When Jared Allen is there, and Jared Allen can be your rim protector, and you can assign him that, and you can, you know, move him in coverage where he's protecting the rim, and then Mobley can go be a help defender, especially if you put him on the weaker of the other two teams' big men, and he can shade off and he can just go help. My God, with his long arms and the way he can move and the way he can cover ground and his fundamentals and his ability to challenge shots, I mean, no big man in the NBA, well, I don't want to say no, but almost no big man in the NBA can get out the three-pointers the way defenders he does. And then when you have Allen in there, you free him up to do that. But the impact that I felt with Jared Allen instantly was they had an interior guy who could create offensive rebounds, who could clean up shots. Obviously, he's always been a high field goal percentage guy. So whether he's an alternate option offensively, or he's a, you know, an offensive rebound putback option, he's just terrific. And so, and I think it underscores that the Cavs, while they have that great offensive, while they have those great guards, they do need a little bit more of a scoring kick. And Allen kind of provides it. I don't know if you want to have that, rely on that a lot, but when Allen was out, their defensive numbers stayed pretty good, but their offensive numbers went down. He comes back in, offense goes right back up. That actually was saying something in that game.
Great stuff, Brian, here on the 5 Good Minutes with Brian Windhorst coming up. Cavs got some matchups with the Kings, and they got about a week's version of the Mavs as well. They'll be down in Dallas and, of course, welcoming Luka and the team up here in Cleveland. So we got a lot to cover here every single week. Social media platforms, YouTube channel. If you don't subscribe yet to the ESPN Cleveland YouTube page, do it so you can get every single week our 5 Good Minutes with ESPN NBA analyst Brian Windhorst. For Danny Cunningham, I'm Matt Fontana. Thanks for tuning into this edition of 5 Good Minutes with Windy.